through June. So if you're feeling restricted back where you are, you need some room to move, well, just come up here and join the kids.
You are my beloved, and I am yours. You brought me out of darkness into your marvelous light. You clothed me in a robe of righteousness, and covered me with a garment of praise. And I am yours,
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 and you are mine.
join in with the angels and the heavenly creatures and all of the earth, worshiping your holy name, Lord, because you alone are worthy. You alone are worthy to receive all the glory and honor and power and praise.
Surrounding your throne, O Lord, Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Can I have the family come up here for a moment, please? Right in the middle of this song, I want to do this. Right at the beginning of this song, I want to pray like this. I want to pray like this. I'm terrible with names. What's your name?
Sate.
I'm terrible with names. I call my wife by the wrong name. That's bad, you know, but Sate. Sate right now, she's a young lady's been coming here for a while that we know is dealing, she's been fighting cancer. And today she is somewhere between heaven and earth and her body. She needs a miracle. She needs a miracle to stay on the earth. And may people know God's still in that miracle business. Y'all believe with me, right? I'm gonna do something here. I've only done one other time in this church. Right now, they've had to revive her once or twice. I understand they had to bring her. If you don't believe God heals, this may sound rude to you, but can you step outside for a minute, please? I don't want non-believers, none in the building right now, because we need a miracle. All right, we all saying we believe God still heals, right? All right, I'm not trying to be rude or anything like that. Jesus did this, by the way. He did this one time. He asked a person to step out of the room if they didn't believe the woman was sleeping. Amen. And I just want you to believe that something. I'm going to believe right now. We know God's perfect will always be done in whatever we pray. But my Bible says, all about yours, but mine tells me in Isaiah 53 and somewhere in 1 Peter again, that by his stripes we are healed. So if God wants to take her home, he doesn't have to make her sick to take her home. Amen. I took purposely uncovered this sign today because I believe in miracles. I am one. I was in a coma between hanging between heaven and earth once many years ago. Take that, Pastor. And my mother wouldn't let me go, and now I'm preaching the gospel today. I was so full of heroin and drugs, they told my mother if I came out of it, I'd be a vegetable. Well, my wife says that's still up for grabs once in a while, but anyhow. But God, somebody say it with me. We're going to anoint the husband with oil just to stand in the place for her, for his wife. Amen. This is her covering on the earth. I mean, people know the Lord's her covering everywhere, but her husband's the covering on the earth.
But before we pray, I just want to say one thing. When we were here Friday night at all night prayer, and Pastor Wayne was praying for Pastor Gwen, who's also dealing with cancer, and he was speaking about power and unity, and God just really spoke to me and said, when we speak the name of Jesus in unity, that power has to go forth from that. So when we're praying today and we pray in the name of Jesus, I want everybody to just yell Jesus, because power is going to go forward out of that name.
When we sing this song today, do it as a war march. Even if you got to get out and march around this place, if you feel so, this is Rock Church. This is not odd for this house. Amen. You want to get out and march. Richard, you want to get up and walk around? We'd be real pleased to see that. Amen. But we're going to believe God for the miracle right now. Come on, church. Stretch your hands for. Oh, rabakashatarararatete. Yitarabakoratararasete. Father, we stand in agreement. We stand in agreement with you and with each other, Lord God, that her body be made whole. Cancer, we curse you. We curse cancer at its very root. It has no authority in the children of God. Now we send this word, God, into the hospital. There's no separation between us and there. We are bone of bone and flesh of flesh, brothers and sisters, family. We have the same Father, and we send forth the word right now in the name, come on, of Jesus. We believe for healing. Let's worship the Lord.
Every chain.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. We have so much to do yet before I hand the service over to our guest speakers. Go get your tithes and your offerings ready right in this anointing. Ooh. Wow, I almost went down. Right in this anointing. Please, let's give it. Let's give under the anointing. Don't wait to give. I would love to see this church learn that when you feel led to the Lord to bring your tithes and your offerings forward and not have us get up here and do all kind of fanfare. When a church learns to give because their heart's set on fire, then revival will start. One of the first signs of revival is that people are giving. People start giving. Come on, saints. I know I wanted them to sing. They're going to sing a song, but people are bringing it up here. We're going to pray over it. Please be at your tithes. If you don't have anything to give, lift your hand. Somebody around here will put a dollar bill in it. I'm serious now. I want everybody to participate. If you have nothing to give, there's a hand up there. Somebody put a dollar bill in Catherine's hand. Back in his hand back there. Come on, somebody stick a dollar bill in their hands back there. If you don't have it, I'll give it. My wife's got plenty of money. Amen. Come on. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Bless your people as we come to give. It's not about how much you give, saints. It really isn't. God can multiply from your seat up to here. It's about your heart attitude. Giving is part of worship. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. I know they're going to sing a little song, and then I'm going to do some work up here. So let's continue to worship when you give, when you bring your tithes and your offerings. Go ahead, guys, anytime you're ready. Thank you, Father. Father, we thank you for what you have done for us and what you allow for us to do for you, God. Father, we ask that you bless this offering, God, multiply it, that the gospel may continue to go out of this place, God, and affect not just our city, but God, all around this nation, Lord. As we get ready to do something here, God, that's mixed emotions, God, but it's according to your gospel that we do this, Lord. God, now multiply this back to the giver, Lord God, that there may always be meat and fruit in their house, God, that their homes will always be a place, God, of hospitality, Lord God, that they'll always have bread to break with their neighbors and their loved ones, Lord. Now we thank you and we ask, God, that your blessing upon it, let all God's people say, amen. Amen. Now turn around real quickly and just greet a person too, hug a neck. If you don't know a person, ask them their name and see if you can get to meet somebody you haven't met before and do something different, amen. We won't be long. We got a lot to do yet, saints, amen. It's time's already ticking away. Oh, I'm going to start singing if you don't get a seat soon, saints. Watch my church, how quickly they'll run back and sit down now. Amen. Whoa. Wise men say only fools. I'm only going to make me start singing a solo up here if you all don't find a seat soon. See how quickly my church ran? Look, come on. Hallelujah. All right, saints, do we have a children's church and nursery and all today? Can the children stay right here during this ordination first? And afterwards, we'll release them. I want the children to see part of what God does. Amen. Rock Church, let's go. Find a seat so we can get DeMarcy and Robert up here and get this show on the road. Amen. Hallelujah. A little over 16 years ago, my wife and I were attending the Rock Church of Virginia Beach, and our time came to be sent out. And Brother John said something as he took the microphone. We were getting ready to get prayed for and be sent out and ordained and all those good things. And wait a minute, time out. My wife just reminded me, before I get serious, she wants to do something else first. So can we pause, hit the pause button? Remember, being sent out, we'll pick up right there again. Amen. Sweetheart, come on. Let's give this beautiful lady a great big God bless you.
Kristen and Misty, if you would come up and join me, and DeMarcy. We just want to honor you today and present you with something. As many of you know, we have a chili cook-off fundraiser every year. And for the last several years, between the three of us, we've taken first, second, and third place. But DeMarcy would strive every year to overcome us. And so we just want to honor her today for her faithfulness in trying to make a good pot of chili. Kristen, you want to say anything?
Well, in all honesty, DeMarcy's, at least in my opinion, was probably the best because it was gourmet chili. However, she did not check out the judge board, and they probably were not gourmet people. Yes, but it was awesome. And in fact, this year I was kind of looking around, and everything looked like my chili and looked like your chili, and there was nothing that stood out. So I really missed your chili this year, even though you totally on Facebook said, "Who can win a chili with corn in it?" Which was mine. But anyway, thank you.
I think this year all of ours had corn in it.
Mine had no corn.
No, hers had no corn. And you got first this year, right? No, you did. Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
See? Corn wins every time. The corny lady. But DeMarcy's the only person I know who can take 4 days to make a gourmet chili and be very upset and lose. But... But it was hilarious. I think last time we said everybody's pot of chili was DeMarcy. So you won first, second, and third.
I just have to say the 1 year she texted me, our chili cook-off is on Sunday after service. She texted me on Thursday, I think it was, and said, "Roasting the poblano peppers on the grill now for the chili." Yeah. And then Friday I got another text about cooking the meat and cutting up the peppers and the tomatoes, and I said to her, "I'm not even going to make mine till like 9 o'clock Saturday night," you know. And she started, and I won that year, and she started like 3 days early. So we have to give her credit for everything that she did to try to win. And so we want to present you, DeMarcy, with an honorary award for the most competitive chili cook-off entrance.
Before you go anywhere, can the three judges stand up from this year? They're here. Are you here? Three judges here? None of them here? Here's the... That was a couple months ago. The one thing was, they said one thing for sure, this was the best pot of chili that Marcy ever made. She didn't put one in. Now, come on, let's thank her. God bless you guys. Now, where was I? Sent out. Okay. Anyhow, Brother John said to Kim and I, he said, "This is one of the hardest things we have to do. When you have to send out somebody you don't want to send out. It's easy to send out those that you want to leave. That's easy. Now you start picking them. Would you like to go anywhere?" I mean, you know. But the ones you don't want to send out, it's harder. When he even went in to pray, he said to us, he said to the Lord, "Father, we know these two are to go, but if you seem it fit for the prophets to say they're going to stay, we'll accept that, Lord." Leadership, did you hear that prayer? Amen. But no, these two, it's time. My leadership can come stand with me, please. My elders, my deacons, and all those can come stand with me. Robert and DeMarcy, if you can come stand with me too, please. They're elders now, but they're going to be leaving here as reverends. Amen. We're going to ordain them and send them out. one of those for each one of you, and I get one. My job here, part of my job is to exhort them, to give them a charge, and I'm going to do that before we go into the covenant here. We met a couple, about, I guess it was 6-7 weeks ago, we were having lunch together, and we're sitting there talking about this day and sending them out and all this, and all of a sudden the Lord gave me a word. And DeMarcy started to cry, cracked me up. I said to him, I said, I see you guys going out as shepherds, as pastors. DeMarcy went, no, I don't want to be a pastor. But I don't see them in this kind of a setting. They have a ministry called Doorway to Freedom, if you don't know, and it's to help those coming out of lifestyle changes. And a lot of it was homosexuality, but it's other lifestyle changes also. And when I was sitting there, we were just talking, and I kept seeing a home meeting. Not a church setting, but a home church type of setting. And I saw them ministering to people. And out of this ministry, people were getting their lifestyles changed. I saw birthing start happening in different settings. I started seeing a young married couples group being needed. Then I started seeing a young parenting couples being needed, and so forth and so on. Then all of a sudden, when I look back at the two of them again, I saw them sitting with the leaders of these groups. They were no longer running just individual groups, but they were starting to pastor leaders of the home studies. And then they asked me to come up and just be part of it. And when we sat there, I started looking at the fact if they would gather them all together, all the groups together, would have been about 160 to 170 people. What a great, we're only averaging about 70 here on Sunday mornings. So, and this is 16 years old, so what a great start for a church, amen? But I saw their church not taking a structured building like we've done with the storefront here, but actually meeting like the book of Acts did, from home to home to home, and causing that to be individually meeting the needs of the people. So I challenge you guys, don't be so set and finding structure, but allow the Holy Spirit to guide you and direct you. If it changes the structure, you'll know what to do. But let the Spirit of God change you, control you. Amen? After I'm finished this, we're going to lay hands on them and pray for them. And leadership, if you have anything, then the microphones will be available. This is your ordination vows. First of all, I present to Rock Church of Tampa Bay here, Robert and DeMarcy Brock. Do you hereby pledge your faithfulness to the call of Jesus Christ, to the work of the ministry, and your desire to be formally ordained to the office for which you are called? Do you accept the commission of the ministry of the gospel of Jesus Christ of no worldly ambitions or desire for earthly gain, but solely for the love of God and your fellow men, that Christ may be glorified and men may be led to his great salvation through your services to him? You solely promise that your utter extent of your ability, you will perform the duties of the ministerial office, that in and out of the pulpit, by both word and deed, you will earnestly endeavor to show forth the praises of him who has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Will you conform both your preaching and your life to the gospel of Jesus Christ as revealed in his God's holy word? And will you extend the kingdom of Christ to the salvation of men and the glory of God? The scriptures in Ephesians 6:1-3 and Corinthians 4:15-17 and Philippians 2:22 all talk about the very things we just spoke of there, about taking care of God's people, God's grace. In scriptures, you are admonished to honor your parents and the Lord so that you may live a long life. Will you, in accordance with the example set forth by Paul and those he fathered, display honor and loyalty to those over and beside you? Do you and your organization, Doorway to Freedom, thoroughly understand and agree with your responsibilities back here to Rock Church of Tampa Bay and its bylaws? This is very little, as far as I'm concerned. Do you, the members of Rock Church of Tampa Bay, receive these candidates into our fellowship, pledge to honor, encourage, and prayerfully support them as they devote themselves to the service of God's people? And with all the power and all, that could have been interesting, huh? You could have said no, we could have kept them here, amen? And the authority that God's given me as an ordained minister from the RMF. You're going out of here through Rock Church of Tampa Bay, not the Rock Ministerial Fellowship. You're under me, not Bishop. No, but with all that, we'll always be here to support you, guide you, direct you, and have you come back, please, once in a while and say hello and all those good things. Amen? Well, we challenge you. And right now, before the body comes to pray or lay hands on you, may I present to you for the first time in public, Reverends Robert and DeMarcy Brock. Amen. That's how she got in the first time. All right, let's pray. Come on, lay your hands on them, church. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Father. Father, we thank you for these two, Lord. As we lay our hands upon them now, God, I just say, remember the words of the Lord that have been spoken over you in this house, that you're leaders. You're to set the example for people that you go out and you live by and you work by. Lord, I just pray, God, that they continue to take grace and mercy where they go. God, not by the letter of the law. This house believes in reconciliation, God. We believe in the grace and mercy of God. And I just ask, God, that you allow that grace and mercy to be poured out through these two. Wherever they travel, wherever they go, God, let them learn first, how would Jesus handle this? And Jesus always moved with compassion. Let compassion, God, not let just worship and the letter of the law to hit every note and everything be their heart, God, but let it be one that will play on the heartstrings of men, not guitars and keyboards. God, let their words cut into people's souls, into their hearts. God, that people may be set free. Use them mightily for your kingdom. Amen. Anybody have a word or encouragement?
I am. The Lord just spoke to me and reminded me of where it says in the Bible that we should go back to these altars to remember, to encourage ourselves and to strengthen us. And I just feel like He wants you all to know that today is an altar for you and that you should hold on to the day and what is happening right now and to remember it and to revisit it when you need it and to use it to put you further in your ministry and that He has mighty things for you that you cannot even imagine, that you can't see. And that Nashville will be forever changed because you are you all and your ministry is there. Thank you, Lord.
The word God's put on my heart for you guys is expansion. Let me get around here. On Friday night, while you guys were worshiping, I just looked up at you guys and I was thinking about all the things I know about you guys. And how there was a time individually for both of you where the devil was meaning to destroy you. And what the devil meant for bad, God turned it around for good. And there was this period of your lives before you came here that you were being restored. And then there was a time when you were here that you were restored. And you were being tested. And I began to think about some of the things I know where I knew you guys were being tested. And I watched you guys stand up here with such grace, like there was nothing going on, still continuing your call, still doing what you were supposed to do, with a smile on your face, even though your heart might have been breaking on the inside. And now you guys are being put on display. You guys are being sent out. And there's expansion that's coming. What the devil meant for bad has already been turned around for good. And it's time for it to be put to use in a way that's not yet been seen. And God's given me a scripture. I should have bookmarked it. It's actually a few verses, but I'm not going to take that much time up. If I can find it here. It's really Jeremiah 31, 1 through 9. I'm just, not to take up too much time, just read a few of these verses. It says, "For thus saith the Lord, sing with gladness for Jacob, and shout among the chief of the nations. Publish ye, praise ye, and say, O Lord, save thy people, the remnant of Israel. Behold, I bring them from the north country, and gather them from the coasts of the earth, and with them the blind and the lame, and the woman with child, and the woman that travails with..." DeMarcy, you have anything to tell us? The woman that travails with child together. "The great company shall return there. They shall come with weeping, and with supplications will I lead them. I will cause them to walk by the rivers of waters in a straight way, wherein they shall not stumble, for I am the father of Israel, and Ephraim is my firstborn."
There's a movement going on in Nashville to bring it back to be known as the Gospel City USA. And I feel the Lord is going to use you through that, but I feel the Lord just telling you to be cautious of what offers come that could lead you away to where your ministry, your calling is, what God's putting you there for. It's not just for families, not just for your grandkids, but He has a purpose for you through all that. It's because of that, but it's not only because of that. But just be cautious of the offers that come to you. God's going to put you through there, and He's going to have you play a part. But just soak it in prayer and tell us to pray for you for these situations, because there's going to be very tempting offers. But just be very prayerful through it all, and God will lead you. And it may not seem the obvious choice, but God will lead you through that.
Can't look at you. God just wanted to remind you that you too are overcomers. And in everything that you do, it shows that overcoming spirit. And where you're going, people need to know how to overcome. And where we're going in the world, that if we don't learn how to overcome things, that we're not going to make it as Christians. And God was showing me that you too are muscular Christians. And that here you've been toned and you've been worked in muscles where maybe was a little off balance, or just, you know, just think of it in just the practical sense too. But so now that you're going into a new season, I know that we've kind of, you and I have talked about, you know, when I go, I'm just going to be with my grandbabies and other things we've talked about. But God is I prayed about this, and He was showing me that it's to wait, to be in that waiting state, because what was needed at our church is not going to be what's needed at their church. It's going to be something different, but you're ready, and just to wait and not just be like, oh, we're here. Grandbabies, come to me. But there's more to it. And DeMarcy, I wanted to share this and remind this to you, but every time I think of it, I cry, so I'm going to have a hard time to say it. But a couple years ago during worship, you were singing a song. I kind of remember the song, but I can't sing, so I'm not going to sing it. But I saw you with your guitar, and the gates of heaven were open, and you were running into to heaven. And it just made that scripture about coming boldly to the throne on a whole different meaning. And thank you for that, and to remember that you two, you couldn't come boldly if you weren't an overcomer. And please teach people that. And anyway, there's so much I just want to be thankful for, but I'll tell you, not in this setting, but after. So I love you guys so much.
Yeah. Well, see you later, Scarecrow. I'm excited for you guys. I really am. And right here, I'm just going to take a moment to tell you, there's a great transition going on in this church right now. With these two leaving, we're transitioning people back into their call. In case you haven't heard yet or anything, of course, our new worship leader has a ministry of also shooting videos at weddings, so she's not here today. Nicole Jones is taking over for their spot. And Robert and Rachel are moving into the youth ministers because Caleb and Shelby, I should have been up here, but Caleb and Shelby are moving in back into where they're supposed to be with the their missions field. They're traveling. They're taking the nations. They fulfilled a place for us that we had a need when his mom and dad left. And Robert, and remember when I told Caleb that Robert was going to become a walker, he went, "Robert, who?" I told him, he went, "Pastor, are you sure?" But the kids and all have really grown to him, and Robert has kicked up a notch in his own heart. So we're putting people back now the way God wants us to move for our next season. And I said that purposely, because when DeMarcy and Robert came here, we were in karaoke, praise and worship. We had people come here that people would pay long lines to get in and sing. We had Elvis Presley gospel being sung here. We had, you know, we were all karaoke, praise and worship. And they came in here, and I'll never forget the first time you took the guitar. I was taken out to lunch afterwards and rebuked by a couple of the elders. They said, "We don't want Peter, Paul, and Mary music in our church." Amen. And I told them, well, God sent them here. And what you two have done, and the reason I know it's God's timing, they have laid a sure foundation for this ministry. They've labored here, and we have about six or seven or better great worship leaders that are willing to jump in here and run with the ministry now. We only have one worship team. We just have a bunch of people that lead it. Amen? And I believe they can. It's not their job to start to build the buildings. They did what they were supposed to do here at Rock Church, and they laid a foundation for our music ministry. So I believe it's God's moving them now to start going on their own. I keep getting the scripture in my brain that keeps saying, you've been faithful with the little things, the few things. You have served another man's ministry. Now God's releasing you to run with your own, and he'll give you roars of 10 cities. Amen. My pastor pastors in Salem, Massachusetts, and our hearts are to close the gap between Tampa and Salem. How many people know now we got to stop somewhere in Nashville? Amen. So God's doing it in the natural first. Amen. Let's give God a great faith. One more time. Let's bless. Father, I seal this day to their hearts as we send them out of this place, God. They don't just get up and go. They're not just running up to babies like Kristen said. They're going with the word of the Lord. Now we send them out of here, Father, and we give you the glory and you the honor. And we thank you, God, for their season with us. And let all God's people say, amen. Amen. Hallelujah. All the children can be released to junior church and nursery and all those good things. And let's keep supporting our ministries now. Robert and Rachel are going to need it because of the youth. Caleb and Shelby are going to need it because they're going to go through with youth withdrawal. Actually, Kate Shelby's going to plan to have about six or seven more of her own. Amen. But now let's get ready. Amen.
I wanted to just take a moment. I know that what I said about for them making this an altar, I'd like to challenge the church to make today an altar for you too. That as the foundation that they laid, that we allow our new worship leaders and the worship team to take us and to continue to draw us higher and higher to the throne of God. That we will look back on this day and be thankful that the Lord blessed us for these years with Robert and DeMarcy, and that we can move forward knowing the foundation is as strong as the rock that we stand on, which is Jesus Christ.
Amen. Hallelujah. We got a couple empty chairs now, saints. Let's fill them back up. Amen. Now, we do have a little fellowship afterwards. We got some sandwiches and we got some nuggets and things like that afterwards. So don't run right out of here. We do have a you want to stick around and talk to them before you leave, please grab a little something to eat. It's just a little something to hold you off so you can go out and have a good lunch. Amen. But right now, I want to introduce to you the Reverends Robert and DeMarcy Brock. Amen. Give them a great big God bless you as they come to minister the word of the Lord.
We thank you very much.
If you're here this morning because of the ordination, this isn't your home church, you've come to be part of what God's doing with us tonight, would you raise your hand? Come on, everybody. Thank you so much. That is so awesome. Thank you, guys, because you are, yeah, doubled attendance today. Thank you very much. No, thank you for, you know, being here instead of your home churches, because I know how much I hate to not be here on a Sunday morning. But you are a part of this, because we've ministered with you, and we've fellowshiped with you, and you've been with us through the good, bad, and the ugly, and the glorious. So thank you for being here. Thank my sister for flying in all the way from Tulsa, on a two-hour delayed flight, and ditching the car on the way to the airport, but she still made it. We had the opportunity to minister with some dear pastor friends of ours, Rick and Debbie Baldwin from Golden Gate Assembly of God down in Naples, and we were supposed to team teach, and I took the whole time. So DeMarcy's going first, and I may not get any time today, but anyway.
I promise I won't be long. Pastors say that doesn't mean anything. Wow. Lord, I just ask that you would anoint me right now, Lord, that you would give me your words to speak. Father, that I would not be a clanging cymbal or a clashing gong, but Lord, you would give me words of life, that you would give me words that would break the yoke. In Jesus' name, amen. Go ahead and turn to Nehemiah 8, verse 1. I want to read one of my favorite passages of all time. I had intended on wearing, honey, hand me my shoe there. I just want to show you what I was planning on wearing. Never mind, I got it. I was going to wear these, but it just could, it was not happening. I wanted to wear them because I knew it was going to be on camera, and, you know, they say that you're not overweight, you're just too short for your weight, right? I'm not, how's that go? Isn't that right? I'm under tall. So if I wore those shoes, I would actually be a little bit closer to the height that I should be for the weight. Yeah, it'd be more proportional. And I was, do these shoes make me look thinner? Oh, and are my sisters online? Well, hi, Ruby. Hi, Kitty. And are Kat and Nicole on there, too? Well, if you are. Hi, Kat. Hi, Nicole. My daughters, of course, couldn't come from Nashville. And yeah, so anyway. Reading from starting in verse 1. All the people came together as one in the square before the water gate. They told Ezra, the teacher of the law, to bring out the book of the law of Moses, which the Lord had commanded for Israel. So on the first day of the seventh month, Ezra the priest brought the law before the assembly, which was made up of men and women and all who were able to understand. He read it aloud from daybreak until noon as he faced the square before the water gate in the presence of the men, women, and others who could understand. And all the people listened attentively to the book of the law. Ezra, the teacher of the law, stood on a high wooden platform built for the occasion. I can't even get close to this verse that I'm coming to without every single time I read this. It just, beside him on his right stood Mattathiah, Shema, Ananiah, Uriah, Hilkiah, and Masaiah, and on his left were Pedaiah, Mishael, Malkijah, Hashum, Hashbadanah, Zechariah, and Meshulam. I was going to skip those names, but I just wanted you to see that I could at least attempt to read them. What? Yeah. Braggart. Ezra opened the book. All the people could see him because he was standing above them. And as he opened it, the people all stood up. Ezra praised the Lord, the great God, and all the people lifted their hands and responded, Amen, Amen. Then they bowed down and worshiped the Lord with their faces to the ground. The Levites, Jeshua, Bani, Sherebiah, Jamin, Akub, Shebathai, Hodiah, Messiah, all the rest, instructed the people in the law while the people were standing there. They read from the book of the law of God, making it clear and giving the meaning so that the people understood what was being read. I'm going to stop there for now. This is a word that God has had on my heart for a long time now. And as I was praying, Lord, what do you want me to share? This just kept coming back to me and kept coming back to me. It's like there was like a whole plethora. You know, when you're getting ready to share something and you know it's your last time, it's like you're all over the board. But I kept getting tunneled back into this. And I really believe this is a model for revival, this passage. And I know that the reason why the Lord kept tunneling me back to this is because we know we are on the cusp, the crest of revival in this place. And we know we've had all these words that no eye has seen, no ear has heard what I'm about to do in this place. But there's a cost. There's a cost, and we have to be willing to pay the price for revival. And that's where we need to really search ourselves, search our souls, and ask ourselves, and be honest when you ask, am I willing to pay that price? Now, I don't want that to scare you, because it also says that my yoke is easy and my burden is light. It's not a burden. It's not a yoke. It's not a heavy strain under a heavy yoke. It's a pleasure. When you step into, just like Pastor's been preaching on, you know, the secret of the secret place and staying in that secret place, when you get there, you realize these heavy burdens that you've been carrying, they were never yours to carry. They were never meant to be there in the first place. So don't let that scare you. Yes, there is a price to pay. And yes, there is, if you will persevere, if you will push through it. How many people in here I know of our church have started reading The Secret of the Secret Place or have been reading it? Push through. It's just like that book says. Man, that book has changed my life. If you will persevere, if you will continue to press in and push through those doldrum days, you will get to that place where God is just like, whew, he's taking you up into heaven. When we were in Nashville house hunting a few weeks ago, one of the pastors, staff pastors at the church was sharing, she had a testimony how she was sitting in her living room. She had a great time where she was by herself. She was going to be by herself for a couple of hours. Her friend had just left. She grabbed her cup of coffee, sat on the couch with her cup of coffee, turned on the worship music, and then whoo, all of a sudden, she was just like outside of her body and just saw just the clouds of God and just the swirl around her. And then all of a sudden, her friend came back in, and she was like, whew, she was out of that moment, and she was really angry. She was like, it's only been 10 minutes. Why are you already back? You know what, you know, she was like, and she was trying to be nice and not get upset about it, and she's like, what do you mean? I've been gone for 2 hours. She thought it was 10 minutes in her living room. People, those are the types of experiences that God intends for us to have in these last days. Because in order for us to be able to, when the enemy comes in like a flood, the Lord will raise up a standard against him. And like a flood, he will come in and He will download power to you that you need in these last days. He will give you. He's already given you everything that you need in your that you need. It's already in your hand. We need to get to that place where we understand that it's already in our hands. And we need to get to the place, we need a paradigm shift in our thinking. I'm trying to hurry. Okay. So Nehemiah 8:1, all the people came together as one in the square. There's got to be unity. In that unity, that's where that commanded blessing comes in. We have got to nip dissension in the bud. We are blessed right now to have a church that is just so unified. But I don't care how great the church is, how healthy the church is, and especially the more healthy churches, the enemy will come in and he will do everything he can to bring that disunity. And, you know, that word that says, do not let the sun go down on your anger, that's not just meant for husbands and wives. That's meant for us as brothers and sisters in Christ. Do not let the sun go down. If you have somebody that has done an ought for, you know, whatever that means, has done something against you, go to that person. Don't let the enemy even have a sliver of an opening to come in and cause any kind of dissension in the body. And Nehemiah, going down to Nehemiah 2, Ezra brought the law before the assembly, which was made up of men and women. You got to realize this was like tens of thousands of people assembled there. And all who are able to understand, from even young children who are old enough to understand, all through, you know, men and women. And it had been the first time in probably many, many years that a lot of these people had even heard the word of God. And there is significance in that. God didn't just give us a book to read. It was more than just words on a page. It's our love letter. It's our instruction manual to know how to minister to somebody, how to minister to yourselves. Study the word, just like it says in that book. You know, secret of the secret place. Study the word. Don't just go for the low-hanging fruit. Okay? Don't just settle for the low-hanging fruit. God will give you. He'll meet you where you are. Okay? He'll give you what you need. But I'm going to tell you something. If you just settle for the low-hanging fruit, you are really missing out. I was out, I love bird watching, and I was bird watching with my sisters? Did one of my sisters go with me? I don't remember. No, Pete and Chris. The last time we went to Black Point Drive was Pete and Chris. And we were doing the bird watches, beautiful drive. It's like a 9-mile loop, and it's a beautiful place. And there was a couple, I noticed this couple who were kind of parked at a bush or like at a, on the side of the road with really nice camera, and they were just sitting and waiting. And so I walked over and I was like, what are you looking at? And he said, oh, it's a rare bird. I think it was a green heron. And he said that, but they're very shy and you have to wait for them to come out. And so I sat and I waited with them. And all of a sudden I saw it and it's like, you just look up green heron, Google it. It's beautiful. And I realized, I was like, wow. If I hadn't been willing to sit and wait, I would have missed that. I would have missed that. And it's the same way in the Word. If you are not willing to sit and wait for that which is more difficult, more precious, and be willing to sit and wait to pull down heaven. There was a time when it was before Robert and I. Robert and I were just hanging out. We weren't... we were still just friends. Of course, you know, we kind of got engaged before we had a date. It's weird. Don't try this at home. But we were just still hanging out as just friends. And I'd had a conversation with him. I said, you know, don't ever, you know, I just want you to know, just full disclosure, full honesty, I'm a little struggling with keeping things just as friends, but don't worry, I won't ever tell you God told me that you're going to be my husband. So, and then he tells me a week later, he's like, yeah, I just want you to know I'm having the same problem, only the opposite. And in my mind immediately leaps to, oh my God, he's repulsed by me. And he said, it's because I had said, when we're together, it's fine. It's when we're apart that I think, you know, lines of friendship become gray for me. And he said, no, it's when we're together that I start thinking, maybe this is for more than just friendship. So one day I'm in my little prayer garden and I'm praying away and I'm like, God. And we had decided, because we had discussed, should we stop spending less time together because, you know, of this issue? And we both decided, no, that we felt that God was using our relationship to complete his healing. And so I'm in my little prayer garden and I'm like, God, I don't want to be the one you use to heal him and just have it benefit somebody else. It's not fair. And I'm just like, I'm having this gripe session, groaning. I'm groaning in the Holy Spirit. What'd you say? I'll find out later. So I get up, I finish, and I get up and I start to walk back into the house, and I hear this voice. It says, and now I will show you the most excellent way. I said, oh, we're not done, are we? And so I turned around and I went back and I went, opened up to 2 Corinthians 13, second or first? First. 1 Corinthians 13. And the Lord just literally, he's speaking to me through his word. And he's telling, when it gets to that part, he goes, love never fails. Love always hopes, always perseveres. And the Lord just like, I will not fail you. No matter what, you can trust me. You can trust me. You just keep doing what I've told you to do and trust me that I will protect your heart. And look what he did. But you know what? If I had just stopped at that, you know, God, I don't want to do this. I would have missed out on something so precious that I will never forget. So be a good listener. So Nehemiah 8:5 Ezra opened the book. God. That picture just wrecks me every single time. Ezra opened the book and everybody, and he's on a huge platform because remember there's tens of thousands of people. He's on a huge platform so that they can hear him, they can see him. He opens this precious word of God and everybody stands up. And do you know what that is? That's expectation. That's expectation. They knew God is about to do something incredible here that we haven't seen in our lifetime. You have to come into the assembly with expectation. You have to realize that when you come into this building, you come in here with your atmosphere. Your atmosphere, whether it's good or bad or indifferent, whatever it is, you come in this door with it. And you can affect what happens in this place. I mean, imagine what it would be like if everybody who came in next Sunday came in like Pastor. Imagine what it would be like if you came in here full of the Word of God, full of expectation. You prepared your hearts before you got here. everybody. It would just be crazy in here. It would be bedlam. It would be bedlam. It's not about what songs, it's like Pastor said, it's not about what songs. It wouldn't matter what songs we did this morning, honestly. It wouldn't matter. Because it's not about the song. It's not about the words. It's worship, to be perfectly honest. The corporate songs that we sing, they're just a tool. They're just a tool to get you to that place of spontaneous worship. That is the worship that that he inhabits, the spontaneous worship. And if everybody came in, bam, from the very first note, you would see incredible things happening in this. I mean, we already see incredible things happening in this house, but it would be exponentially greater than anything no eye has seen, no ear has done. But Pastor, didn't you say something about that was what it was, the mixing of our pot? We're pot mixers. That's what he said. But that's what that is. I mean, that's what I'm talking about, is everybody coming. When you come together, everyone has a word, a psalm, a hymn, a spiritual song, a tongue, an interpretation of a tongue. It's for somebody in here. The word that you got when you were in that quiet place and you tarried and you waited for the fruit that you can't reach, the only way you can get to that fruit is if the Holy Spirit plucks it and gives it to you. The only way you can get that fruit, and God gave it to you, and all of a sudden somebody has you pray for them, and you're, bam, that word comes to your mind. I'm like, oh my gosh, this was for you. I thought it was for me, but this is for you. That's what this is all about. This is all about equipping for the ministry of the saints. God's equipping us to pour it out. I'm almost done. Nehemiah 8:8. They read from the book of the law of God, making it clear, giving the meaning so that the people understood what was being read. There are going to be times, there are going to be things that happen in here that you're not going to understand what it is. You're going to say, I'm not really sure that's God. I remember, when decades ago, during the time that the Brownsville thing was going on, the church that I was in Memphis, Tennessee, was having the same things happening. We had no idea were happening over here. And we had, you know, one person over here on the ground, another person over here laughing hysterically, another person over here crying. And it was just like every service was like that. And I remember when I saw the laughter, I was like, well, that's not God. Like, really? That's just, okay. I just have a confession to make right now. I am a recovering Presbyterian, and my name is DeMarcy. Say hi, DeMarcy. But that was like really weird for me. But I went to the scriptures and I was like, okay, Lord, if this is you got to show me. And bam, he took me to the scriptures on laughter, and they came carrying their sheaves. I don't remember exactly. I wish I'd, well, this was, you know, this is free. This kind of just popped out. But, you know, they were overcome with joy. And I was like, okay, well, that's kind of what that looked like. They were overcome with joy, and they could not stop what was happening. And see, those of you that know me, you know, I don't really need that. To me, you know, crying was definitely of the Holy Spirit. I had that in spades. I was all, what? Push! Yeah. You don't want to know what that is. But just know that there are going to be times that you're not going to understand. and search the scriptures yourselves first before you go to the leadership and see if God will give you the answer. And then if you still don't get it, then go to trust your leadership. We have the most amazing leadership. You know, I know Pastor has always said, I'll weigh my sheep against a church twice my size any day of the week, and the weight of my sheep will beat theirs. Well, we have that in the same way. We have that in our pastors. You weigh our pastors against pastors from another church twice our size, we have more wool. We have more wool in this house. God has set up this house to be, literally, if you look around, everybody in here are leaders. This house is set up for revival. It is set up for when you look around and you see, I don't need to belabor that, but you get it, right? All right, just a couple more, I'm done. I was looking at Robert. Sorry, honey. Yeah. And verse 9, then Nehemiah the governor, Ezra the priest, and the teacher of the law, and the Levites who were instructing the people said to them all, this day is holy to the Lord your God. Do not mourn or weep, for all the people had been weeping as they listened to the words of the law. Nehemiah said, go and enjoy choice food and sweet drinks and send some to those who have nothing prepared. This day is holy to our God. Do not grieve, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. And I would encourage you to study out Nehemiah 8 and 9 and look and see what God shows you that he requires of you for this revival, in preparation for this revival. But the word reveals the greatness and the holiness of God. So he's reading the word. The Levites are giving interpretation because the word was originally in one language and they had no longer were speaking that language, so there was interpretation going on, literal interpretation, also explanation going on. And when you come face to face with the holiness of God, you can't help but be faced with your own inadequacies, your own ugliness. And that was what was happening here. Revival brings repentance. And I don't care how holy you are, it's ugly compared to the holiness of God. And even if you think you've got it all together and you don't have anything to repent for, we have a nation to repent for. Okay, maybe you're having a good day and you didn't sin today. Well, we need to stand in the gap for our nation. I remember one more story and then I'm going to quit. Is that okay? You like my stories? Let me read this first. It's the goodness of God that brings repentance. Come with humility into his presence and be willing to allow God to put his finger on the sin in your life. I remember one time I was sitting in church and the message was on forgiving your others. You know, if you have somebody, something against somebody, you know, leave your gift at the altar and go. And I'm looking around like, I'm good. Nobody in here I'm upset with. I don't think anybody's upset with me. Of course, I did find out later that I do have a tendency to really tick people off and not even know it. So I may not have been in as good shape as I thought I was, but I'm sitting there and I'm like, I'm good. Nobody here. Yeah. That was at Clearwater Vineyard, you guys. My brain just went blank. Pastor John Stearns. Yeah, John Stearns was talking about forgiveness. And all of a sudden, the Holy Spirit put his little finger on something. And he says, what about this person? And I was like, oh, well, that person's not even a Christian. And they really hurt me. So, yeah, I don't think that's happening today. And the Holy Spirit is like, really? And I finally was like, okay, I really do not have the ability in me to forgive this person. Honestly, I'm being honest with you, Lord. I can't do it. But you know what? I know you. I know you well enough to know that you can work that out in me if I'm willing to give it to you. So I said, Lord, I'm going to give this to you right now. And I'm going to ask you to work it out. And you know what? He did. Isn't that amazing? I was like a week later, like it was somebody that I had dated and he was false with me and I was really hurt. And he was already seeing this other person, and I was like, I was definitely not forgiving her. And it was like a week later, I'm laying in my bed, and I see this videotape of me. And by now, okay, I was like, it's gone. There is no unforgiveness in my heart. I have forgiven them. And all of a sudden, I see this videotape of me sitting down with them in my living room and telling them that I forgive them. I'm like, okay, God, that's weird, but if this is you, if you're going to make it so. I'm a Trekkie. So a few days later, my car breaks down, and somehow or another, Joe ends up coming over to fix my car, and he's got his girlfriend with him, and I was like, oh, my gosh, are you kidding me? So I waited till he fixed the car. Because I'm no dummy. And they're in my living room like, oh, my gosh, this is crazy. So I said, Joe, yeah, I just want you to know, I'm not saying you did anything wrong, but I want you to know that I forgive you, that God has worked out in my heart, I forgive you. And Leslie, I forgive you, and I want you to both know I love you. And I ended up going and getting some Taco Bell or something with Leslie, and Leslie's sharing with me all of her problems with her relationship with Joe, and I'm counseling her on the way to Taco Bell. You can't tell me that's not God. He has a sense of humor. And I danced at their wedding. And I just, that is such a testimony. So don't ever be afraid. I remember during a time I was just so faced with my ugliness, but there was a song that was popular at the time, Search Me, O God, and Know My Faults. See if there be any wicked way in me. And it was like, search every little tiny part of my life. That is a dangerous thing to pray. It is a dangerous, he will expose your sin. And maybe not just to yourself. I mean, I'm telling you. But you know what? The harvest of righteousness that comes from that discipline is not to be compared. If it weren't for what God did in me, because I was willing to let him shine that light, I would not have. You know what? I want you to look around in here. This is my harvest. This is my harvest right here. I didn't realize until this morning, the Lord showed me that verse, and the harvest of righteousness. It's not just the harvest of righteousness. Yeah, it's about the harvest of righteousness in you, but it's also about the harvest of righteousness in your life with your brothers and your sisters in Christ who love you, who know you, and still love you. So, with that, I will leave you with my husband.
And seriously, I am not going to take long, but one thing that I've learned from Pastor Brian is if God repeats something, we need to pay attention to it. We did not compare notes on what we were going to share this morning, but there are just like a couple of things that were on my heart that I wanted to share, and she's already taught on them. But I'm going to repeat a couple of things because that's God's way of saying, you know, pay attention. The other thing, it was a delight to hear Pastor Brian say he was sad to send us out, because I think there probably were some times where he wouldn't have been so sad to send us out. But it has to do with revival. Revival is coming. It is coming to this area. It has been coming for a long time. Those of us that have been in other churches prior to here, it's been coming since back then. And one of the things, this is actually something God spoke to me Friday night. For those who don't know, we did have a almost all-night prayer meeting. We started at 10 and wrapped up at 5. I only made it till 3, I'll admit. But part of what we were praying for was seeking God's direction, marching orders for the coming revival. What are we to do? What is our part? Because it's not just in this church, it's in the area. And this is something that God spoke to me very clearly. When revival comes, just because you don't understand it does not mean it's not of God. Listen for the heartbeat of the movement. If it is in rhythm with the heartbeat of God, then it is from God and of God. Keep an open heart and ask Him to help you understand and accept the things that you don't understand. Several years ago, I toyed with the idea of writing a script called Don't Let the Parade Pass You By. And the focus of it is the day of the triumphal entry. And Jesus is coming in, and the disciples are making all this noise and racket as they go by the temple. And in the temple are the Pharisees diligently looking over the scrolls. When is the Messiah going to come? We're looking for the Messiah. And they get upset because of all the noise. And they go outside. Can't you keep the racket down? We're looking for the Messiah. And they're so focused on what they thought he should look like according to their precepts that they totally missed he was right in front of them. So that is a challenge. When revival comes, don't let the parade pass you by. Also, most of us, probably all of us, have a word from God. We've got a promise. And for those that weren't able to join us Easter morning, we had an incredible experience where God had given Pastor this vision to have us come up on the platform. We had a tomb scene for part of the morning service. And he had us come up back behind stage and walk out of the tomb on Resurrection Sunday and just bring back to life the visions and the plans and the words that God had spoken over us, that maybe just because it's taken so long, we've gotten weary and we've even begun to doubt or forget. And I know that has been a life-changing experience for many in this church. But one thing God spoke to me this week was, don't make an Ishmael when I've promised an Isaac. Don't try and force God's plan to come to pass before its time. There is the now and the not yet. God's timing is perfect, ours is not. God once told me to learn to discern the seasons of my will. And so that is a word of encouragement. Hold on to that promise that God gave you. If you've gotten weary in it, ask Him to help you breathe new life into it. But don't look for ways to make it happen. When it's God's timing, you will know it. John chapter 21, verse 20 and 22, which I'm sorry, Rachel, I didn't ask you to have anything loaded. It's the story where Jesus is appearing to the disciples after the resurrection, and he's given them their marching orders. He's had a time of
conversation with Peter and restored him and given him that charge to, you know, feed my lamb, feed my sheep. And Peter looks over and he sees John the disciple and he says, well, Lord, what about him? And Jesus gives him in verse 22 a very polite, mind your own business. If I will that he tarry till I come, what is that to you? You follow me. And in that, don't concern yourself with what God's got for others. Focus on what he's got, calling you to do. What marching orders has he given you? If you're looking where someone else is, then your eyes are not on him and they're not on his plan for you. Don't be concerned about titles and there's another word there. What is it? Position. Because the only position you need to look at is where are you in relation to the cross? Are you closer to it today than yesterday, or are you further away? Focus on what God's got for you. Do the work that God's called you to. Matthew 6:33, seek ye first the title and the recognition and the glory. Oh, good. You do read your Bible. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and then everything else will be added unto you. The most fervent servants I've ever met don't have a title, don't want a title, don't want recognition. They just love God, and they just want to do what he's calling them to do. They just want to be with their people. I've heard Heidi Baker say she hates going to conferences because it takes her away from Mozambique. It takes her away from her children there in the orphanage. But she knows she needs to. She knows God's calling her to, but she just can't wait to get back because her heart is with those kids. Don't just read about the experiences in the Bible. Have an encounter with the living Word. The Scripture is given so that we have a point of reference. We know what God's done before. And if God is the same yesterday, today, and forever, then if he did it then, he wants to do it today. If he healed back then, he's going to heal today. If he was the provider, if he provided for Elijah in the desert with food and drink, he's going to do it for us today. But don't just read about God. Get to know the author of the book. Get to have your own experiences. Not that your experiences will replace. They will confirm what God's done. And lastly, this is a worshiping church, so it makes sense that the enemy will attack its people and the church in the area of worship. It's not about the style of worship. It's not hymns versus choruses or traditional versus contemporary. It's about the focus of the worship. Does the worship glorify God? Does it draw me into his presence? Does it put my focus on him and on seeking him and his will for my life? We are called to worship him in spirit and in truth. And I just think it is so amazing that back when we were doing karaoke worship, this church received a prophetic word that the worship of this house would go around the world. Is that correct? That it would be bigger than Hillsong. That it would touch lives and that it would just go everywhere. And, you know, we're singing to CDs. How is that going to happen? And it was just such an honor for us to be a part of that. We didn't see that prophecy fulfilled. And that's okay. We laid a groundwork that now, as DeMarcy said when we had our transferal from she to Nicole for heading up the ministry, my ceiling is your floor. Yeah, my ceiling is your floor because you're going to start where I left off and we're excited. We're not going to be jealous. We are excited. It's going to go so much further than we ever imagined that it might, and it is going to go around the world, not just for glory and honor and fame, but to touch lives. For those of you visiting this morning, you may not have known hardly any of the songs. That's because over half of them were written by worship leaders in this house. God has blessed this house, not just with worship and musicians and singers, but with writing songs that set people free. So, okay, I said last thing, one last thing. Another favorite passage, I have so many favorite passages, Luke chapter 24, verse 32 through 34. This is the account, it's after Jesus' death. some of the disciples had left Jerusalem, were headed to Emmaus. They had not heard yet that Jesus had raised from the dead. And they're walking along, and Jesus comes alongside of them and walks with them, and they don't recognize who he is. And they're sad. This person who we thought was going to be the Messiah, he has died. And actually, I guess they had heard some of the lady folk had come and said that he had been raised from the dead. The tomb was empty anyway, but they didn't know what to think about that. And so Jesus begins to explain it to them. He begins to open up the scriptures to them. And they get to where they're going to stop for the night, and they invite him to come in, and they sit down. And when he breaks bread with them, their eyes are open, and they see. And after the fact, one of them says, "Did our hearts not burn when he spoke?" And just something this week that spoke to me, that in their spirit, I believe they knew something was different about this man in their spirit, but their flesh wouldn't let them accept. So we depend on our five senses in this world, but we have spiritual senses as well, and we cannot become so dependent on our physical senses that we miss God when he's right in front of us. So I just pray for a holy heartburn for all of us, that we feel his presence, that when he is around, we feel it. When he is around, you know, when your heart beats, I want to feel it. You know, when your heart speaks, I want to hear it. I pray that we are so sensitive that regardless of what our physical senses tell us, we know this is God, we know this is not God, we know this is the way, walk ye in it, we know this is not the way, we're going to go the other direction. So, amen. Pastor.
Amen. Now, I'm not going to preach. My wife had a vision of that. Sorry, my knees lock up on me a little bit. My wife had a vision of that over there, and that's not my ideas of the perfect color, red, purple, and blue, but that's what she saw, the heartbeat of God, and even the sign. And if we learn to hear his heartbeat, my heart to walk with the Lord is, I would love to be like John and be able to lay my head upon his chest and learn to hear his heartbeat. Not just my marching orders. I'd love to be able to get it right from his heart. And the book we just finished preaching was The Secret Place, The Secret of the Secret Place. And honestly, I've turned right into a new one now. I don't need books, we got the word, but these books have changed my life. And a new one we're doing is Dutch Sheets' book called The Pleasure of His Company. And next couple of weeks, I'm going to be preaching next week and week after that. And two of my favorite ones in the book. Learn to get into the place where you can only see God. And understand something. It isn't just you desiring his company. But remember, he desires yours. The way you feel. Come on, do you remember when you first fell in love? Remember the time? I mean, it's funny. Last night, Kim and I were discussing some things, and I came down here for a little while in my office. We were discussing things too loudly, should I say. And I came down in my office, and all of a sudden, I started remembering back the day I fell in love with this girl. My sister set us up, and I can remember, and all of a sudden, that joy overtook my heart. I just had to be with her. And I think about that with God. I think how much he loves us. How much he cares. He'll move heaven and earth just for you. He would cause everything to shift to bring you to where you'd be. If you don't believe this, I feel sorry for you. But if I was the only person on the earth, he would have sent Jesus just for me. That may sound arrogant to you, but if I don't believe that in my heart, I can never get up here and preach the gospel on adultery. I got to believe that he loves you that much. That he moved my wife and I 1,600 miles from Baltimore to here, away from our family. I didn't get to watch my grandchildren raise up, because I spent the last 16 years here. I got to see them, of course, but not every day. And I got to believe that God loved you that much to send us here. And he loved me that much to give me you. And if we keep that as a family reference in our hearts, how much he loves you, I promise your life will always be wealthy. It'll be wealthy. Wealth isn't what you carry in your pocketbook, it's what you carry in your heart. Amen. Can we all stand for a moment, please? I'm done. I'm only going to give you one close, and that was it. Amen. If you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ today, if you have fallen away from the Lord Jesus Christ today, this whole service was to send them out, but it was to send you and bring you closer to the wonderful presence of God. I will never forget DeMarcy and Robert. I mean, no matter where God sends them, we've had some, they've been friends. They haven't just been church members, and we laugh, and that push thing, you can ask her afterwards what that's all about. Amen. It's just so wonderful, and I would miss an opportunity if you've fallen away or you're not walking close with God right now, not to give you the opportunity on such a great day that love's been demonstrated in this church. Every eye closed, every head bowed. We're not here to embarrass you. Jesus Christ doesn't want to embarrass you. He just wants to love on you. If you're not walking right with Jesus Christ today, just lift your hand. I want to pray for you. You know you're not. You know you're just not walking the way you're supposed to walk. Promise you, I'm not even going to make you come up to the altar. I'm not going to do that. This is between you and the Lord. It's not between you and Rock Church or you and me. It's between you and the Lord. You don't have to lift your hand. But I'm going to ask you. I'm just going to pray a simple prayer, and I'm going to ask you to repeat it after me. And if you've done it for the first time or you're renewing your spirit, let the Spirit of God touch you. Just repeat after me and say, Father, I have fallen short of your glory. I have fallen short of your promises. I ask you today to renew my walk, to renew my heart, that I may walk closer to you, that I may understand the pleasure of your company as you do mine. I receive my fullness of my salvation and the lordship of you over my life. It's in Jesus' name. Amen. If you've prayed that and it's fresh in your spirit, just let God touch you. And if not, and you need prayer, I'll be up here for a season. Robert and DeMarcy will be up here. And I'm going to release you. Is Missy here? She's still in the kitchen. She's going to be setting some food out there, and we're going to have some fellowship. Just don't rush her till you'll hear her. She'll say ready. Amen. But you're all released now in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.